Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Start with the name of Allah, who is the most beneficent and the most merciful. Assalamu alaikum, dear students. How are you all? Hope you will be fit and fine. This is Safiya Ablo, your botany teacher from Hira Public Higher Secondary School, Sakhar, with another video lecture. Today, in this video, we'll discuss something about microscope. Then, techniques to isolate cellular components. After that, we'll take bit introduction of eukaryotic cells. So, let's start with microscope. Word microscope made up of two Greek words. Micros means small. Scopein, to see, to look. Microscope was invented by David Jensen in 1590. And in 1610, Galileo, he was an Italian astronomer and physicist, designed it properly. The study of cell and microorganisms is dependent upon the use of microscope. By the development of better and more powerful microscopes, our knowledge of subcellular organization has been improved. Now, kinds of microscope. There are various types of microscopes have been designed by the scientists. There are three major types of microscopes according to the source of light. Light microscope, second one X-ray microscope, and the third one electron microscope. Let's start with light microscope. The light microscope, also called optical microscope, it is a type of microscope that commonly uses visible light and a system of lenses to generate magnified images of small objects. Light microscopes are oldest designs of microscopes and were possibly invented in 17th century. Next, X-ray microscope. Instrument that uses X-rays to produce enlarged images of small objects is called X-ray microscope. The basic device uses the emission of X-rays from a point source to cast an enlarged image on a phosphorus screen. X-ray microscope was made in 1951 by British physicist Alice Kesley and William Nixon. Electron microscope. Electron microscope is a technique for obtaining high resolution images of biological and non-biological specimen. The electron beams are used to view thin specimen, generate projection image. Now, features of microscope. These are the important features of microscope. They are magnification, resolution, and contrast. Moving on, magnification. Magnification is the process of enlarging the apparent size of the object. Magnification of a microscope is calculated by multiplying the power of its eyepiece with its magnifying power of its objective. Okay, now resolution. The resolution of an optical microscope is defined as the shortest distance between two points on a specimen that can still be distinguished by the observer or camera system as separate entities. We can say it is a capacity of a microscope to separate adjacent forms or objects. Now, contrast. Contrast is defined as the difference in light intensity between the image and the adjacent background. Contrast is important in distinguishing one part of the cell from another. Contrast is often obtained by fixing and staining the material. Nowadays, most of the subcellular structures are studied by electron microscope. Students, this is all about microscopes. Now, moving to another topic, that is techniques to isolate components of the cell. Cell fractionation. It is a process of breaking down the cell for research, for getting different organelles inside the cell. We can say isolation of cellular components to study their chemical composition is called cell fractionation. Like, if someone wants to research on ribosome, so through this technique, pure ribosome is in hand. In cell fractionation, nowadays usually the process being used is centrifugation. Now, what happens in this process? In this process, we are cracking open the cells in ice-cold environment and we are having a test tube. In this test tube, we just put our cells and having suspension in it. It is rotated first in very low speed. This rotating or spinning action is known as centrifugation. After spinning, high material settle down at the bottom as sediments. But smaller materials or light materials are in the fluid or suspension. We called it supernatant. Now we'll get this supernatant into another tube and again subject to centrifugation at a higher speed until the smaller particles have been separated out. So the various cell fractions can then be biochemically analyzed. By cell fractionation techniques, cellular components are isolated for further studies or for research. Got it, students? Now, moving to another topic, that is eukaryotic cells. Students, recall your memory. In our last lecture, we have learned difference between eukaryotic and prokaryotic cells in detail. Now, in this lecture, we'll discuss eukaryotic cells and its components. Okay, now eukaryotic cells. A typical eukaryotic cell contains three major parts, but fourth component, cell wall, is only found in plant cell. It is absent in animal cells. So, check out. The first one is plasma membrane. The second one is cytoplasm with its organelles. Third one is nucleus. And the fourth, cell wall, that is just present in plant cell and absent in animal cells. Let's start plasma membrane. Plasma membrane is also called cell membrane. All cells are enclosed in membrane that serve as their outer boundary. Separating the cytoplasm from the external environment. This membrane is called as plasma membrane. All biological membrane have the same basic molecular organization. Cell membrane is not a fixed or rigid structure. It is just like an ocean. And in the ocean, there are some boats. Boats are floating in the ocean. So ocean water is not fixed. It is always fluctuating. So boats are also fluctuating, moving from one place to another. द सेम थिंग इज ऑल्सो प्रेजेंट इन प्लाज्मा मेम्ब्रेन और सेल मेम्ब्रेन. इट इज़ अ डायनामिक स्ट्रक्चर. सेल मेम्ब्रेन इज मेड अप ऑफ टू मैक्रो मॉलिक्यूल्स. वन इज लिपिड एंड अदर इज प्रोटीन. Although they are the presence of some carbohydrates. Now question is here, how exactly they arrange in studies in structures. So phospholipids are building blocks in plasma membrane. The phospholipids molecules arranged in two parallel layer in plasma membrane and interspersed with protein. The lipid bilayer polar. In lipid bilayer, there are non-polar hydrophobic ends each other, whereas their polar hydrophilic ends are associated with carbohydrates and protein, etc. Plasma membrane contains several types of lipids, like cholesterol. Cholesterol may be contributed up to 50% in animal cells, but is absent from plasma membrane of most plants and bacterial cells. Got it, students? Okay, we have learned here two new words, hydrophilic and hydrophobic. Hydrophobic, phobic means phobia or fear. So hydrophobic means water fearing and hydrophilic means water loving. Okay, now moving on to functions of plasma membrane. Plasma membrane performs several functions. We know cell membrane is outer covering of the cell. Okay, so it is like the walls of our house. We know that walls protects us from external environmental condition like heat, cold, wind, even wild animals. And exactly the same way, plasma membrane also protects the cell from external environment. Plasma membrane gives cell their unique structure and shape. Plasma membrane helps in packing the organelles of the cell in an organized manner. Cell membrane also separates the components inside the cell from neighboring cells. Like the doors of a home, cell membrane allow the exchange of only specific substance between different cells, means only allow few substances and block the rest. This property of cell membrane of permitting only specific substances is called selectively permeability. So plasma membrane is selectively permeable membrane. It allows only smaller or soluble particles like water to pass through it. For this property, it is also called semi-permeable membrane. This is all about students. With that, we come to the end of this video. I hope that now you understand what we have learnt. In our next video, inshallah, we'll discuss fluid mosaic model of plasma membrane. See you soon. Take care and Allah Hafiz.